please. Doesn't matter how many's here, how many's not here. Let's just praise the Lord.
Let's just praise.
What do you have to be thankful for this morning that we need to praise the Lord for? Miss Betty? It is nice outside. So if they come and kick us out, we'll just go outside and spread out 6 foot. Anybody else? What are you thankful for this morning that we really need to praise the Lord for? Have church, and most all of our church family is healthy. There's a few that are not, and let's remember them as we go throughout the day. Hymn number 488.
By sin and strife, this would fill my heart with pain. Jesus swept across the broken stream, stirred the slumbering chords again. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Feasting on the riches of His grace, resting in His sheltering wing, always looking on His smiling face, that is what I shout and sing. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Though sometimes He leads through waters deep, cries all across the way. Though sometimes He rough and steep, see His footprints all the way. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Back to welcome me, far beyond the starry sky. I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown. I shall reign with Him on high. Jesus, 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 fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go.
Fifth verse, soon He's coming back. We know it's closer today than it was yesterday. And that is one thing that should keep a smile on our face. because it's, as it said there in that third verse, always looking on his smiling face. I don't think we would ever see a frown on Jesus' face. So let's use him as our example and smile as we go throughout, no matter, because we know he went through trials and tribulations, just like we are today. But yet, there is always a smile on his face. Hymn number 504, we may be seated. Shackled by a heavy burden, need a load of guilt and shame, then the hand of Jesus touched me. If he touched you, if he has touched you and made you whole, there's nothing wrong with lifting your hand. As we sing through that chorus one more time, if God has touched you, if Jesus has saved you, it's in your heart today. You can stand, you can raise your hand, whatever. Just to let our Father know. He touched me, oh, he touched me, and all that joy that floods my soul, something wonderful happened, and now I know he touched me. Thank you, Jesus. Hymn number 497. Hymn number 497. This will be our offertory hymn. If you would stand, please.
There is a place of quiet rest near to the heart of God. A place the sin cannot put us. Hold us away before.
Number 385. In number 385, Jesus keep me near the cross. Opportunity to come and sing praises unto you, Lord, and to just have fellowship with you during this short period of time that we have here as a church family. Lord, we just pray that those, you be with those that are unable to be with us today for whatever reason. Lord, just pray with the different, for the different crises that are going on in our country right now. Not just the virus, Lord, but the brutality and things like that, Lord. We know that your hand is the only one that can calm everything. Lord, we just ask for that. Lord, as these ladies come this morning, I just pray that you would just sing through them words of this song that would touch our hearts, that would draw us closer to you, Lord. Lord, too many times we focus on talent and gifts instead of focusing on the message that you have for us. And Lord, I just pray that this morning as these ladies come and that as our pastor comes to follow, that we would truly be listening for the message that would bring us closer to you, Lord. Just thank you again for all you do. Just thank you for these that have come this morning. Just bless them in a special way, Lord. In your name I pray.
This world is not my home. Oh, this world is not my home. My home's been made at heaven's throne. This world is not my home. This life is not my own. Oh, this life is not my own. I am His and His alone. This life is not my own. Bought when love was slain, what high cost to me death's wage, now ransomed I and freedom's slave. My Jesus raised me from the free. soon, Lord, oh, very soon. Oh, soon, Lord, oh, very soon, you'll come take me to be with you.
This morning, our church has been asked, and all Bible-believing churches around the world has been asked, and Brother Randy touched on it just a few moments ago, just to pause just a moment and pray for peace of our country. We understand that the Lord Jesus is the Prince of Peace. We understand that. But we're just going to pause just a moment. We're just going to ask you to bow your head, if you would, and pray as we have this prayer for our nation. There are many that are hurting, not only physically, but probably more so spiritually. And we just pray that before it's eternally too late, that many of our people will come to know Christ, the Son of the living God. We're going to ask you just, if you would, just to bow your head and you pray with me as we just pause and ask God to intervene in this world of ours. We're going to give you just a few seconds before we pray. Father, we come into your mighty, wonderful presence this morning, thanking you for the gift of life and thanking you for the ability to come into this place and have fellowship and hear the singing of these hymns. Father, we know that it's a vital part of what makes us Americans, is the ability to come into the church of the living God and worship. And Father, uplift your holy name. At this point, Lord, our world is in deep trouble. There's a lot of divisions in the land. And Father, it could be the fault of many of our churches that have grown comfortable in their surroundings and not have gone out into our communities and to see, Lord, and to experience maybe some of the things that's out there and to speak, Lord, your truth. Father, what we need today is we don't need more government intervention. Father, we need more God. We need the Lord Jesus Christ to come in a mighty, powerful form to sweep this land, Lord, and bring us to repentance. Father, I pray for the hearts of our people and those, Lord, that have suffered loss of businesses and loss of property and loss of life. Father, I would just pray that in some way that you would send a reasonable voice where those that was out there and conducting, Lord, these mischiefs, that, Father, somehow we could find a starting point of dialogue, Lord, that we could sit down together and see, Lord, where what we could do better. And, Father, I'm not so sure that the blame does not lie in the preachers of our land and the churches of our land. And, Father, I would just pray that we would, every time we have the opportunity to come into the house, that we would uplift you. And Father, it's not about mankind and what we can do, but Father, it's the change and the difference that you can bring that makes the difference. Father, if there would be someone watching today on Facebook or later, Lord, on our Channel 6 broadcast or YouTube channel, Father, I would just pray that maybe a word could be spoken this morning to bring them to Christ Jesus. Father, this could be the moment in time that you are bringing these events to our land to give us one great opportunity to come back to you. And Father, I do not know that, but Father, certainly this could be the moment in time. Father, we read in the Bible, in the book of Esther, that she came to this decision and the things that she had to do for such a time as this. Father, this is a time where we can come and pour our hearts out to You. I pray, Lord, for every pulpit of America today that preaches the truth, that, Lord, that truth would be preached, hearts would be reached, and souls would come into the kingdom. Father, we realize that our words are not enough, but combined with the words of the infallible, inerrant Word of God, it can go places, Lord, that our voices cannot go. And Lord, I just ask that You would bring people back to repentance, that we could see, Lord, what a difference, what a revival could make in our nation, in our homes, in our governments, and in our churches. Father, we thank You for being our God, and we thank You, Lord, that we're just traveling through this old world. And this is not our final home. We're just passing through. And Father, I pray that each and every one of us would declare to make a difference in our work, in our conduct, in the way that we handle things. But Father, I just pray for this service to come. And Lord, as we read Your Word and as we get into Your truth, Father, it would bring us to the point of what we need to do with You. Again, Lord, we thank You for what You're going to do in advance. We thank You, Lord, that You still love us. You still call to us. And Father, we thank God that Your hand is still stretched out to us all. Lord, we love You and we need You in Jesus' name. Amen. Someone once said this, "You can tell much about a person for what they desire. You can tell much about someone by what they want." It's not difficult to determine someone's spiritual interest. All you have to do is check your conversations, check your friends, and check your personal conduct. Another way to tell is your view on Scripture. Is if this Bible is the Word of God, and if this Bible does not change our conduct or change the way that we view things, then obviously we have some problems. I wonder this, and this has been on my heart for some time, and I thought it would be a good opportunity just for us this morning is to just to think about this question. And I want you to ponder this before we get started in any other thing. If you could ask the Lord Jesus for one specific thing, what would it be? If you knew that you had the ears and the heart of God right before you, and He were to just ask you, "What could I do for you?" what would your response be? Now see, your response to that question will tell you a lot of where you are spiritually. Because when I say a question like that, many people would say this, "Well, preacher, if I just had more money in the bank, that would ultimately make me happy." Or, "Preacher, if I just had more of this or more of that, then my life would be complete." I'm going to show you something this morning that maybe we've been thinking about things all wrong. Maybe we view things in the way that only we can in our human effort, in our human mind. But watch this. Maybe there's something more out there that we have not tapped into yet. Would that be a fair subject to look at this morning? Maybe there's just something out there that could benefit you personally that you have just not considered that maybe in a long time. And because the Lord has pressed this on my heart for some time, I wanted us to bring this to you as best that I can. Now, I don't know how far we'll get, and if we don't get finished, we just don't get finished. We can bring it back another time. But I do want to just start by telling you this. There was a man, by the way, this is not our text verse. I'm making a big long commercial before we get to our text verse, okay? There was a man in the Bible that asked God for something. And God did something remarkable to him. And this is where I started thinking about this as I was reading the Bible the other day. But I want you to invite your attention to 2 Chronicles chapter 1. 2 Chronicles chapter 1, verse number 8, if you would. Now, this will get us to our text verse. We're just stopping here to get us to where we need to go. And Solomon said unto God. Now, you might want to mark that or underscore that in your Bible. Solomon now is speaking to the Lord. Watch what he tells the Lord. Thou hast showed great mercy unto David my father, and hast made me to reign in his stead. Now, O Lord, you'll see that word Lord is capitalized. Now, O Lord God, let thy promise unto David my father be established. Give me now watch. Here's what he's asking from God. Give me now wisdom and knowledge, that I may go out and come in before this people, for who can judge this people that is so great? Now, early on, Solomon had a pure heart. He did not ask the Lord for wealth, but rather wisdom. Now, skip down to verse number 12 and see the result of this prayer. Verse number 12. Wisdom and knowledge is granted unto thee. Now, watch. And I will give thee riches and wealth and honor. Now stop, everybody, look up here. Are you still with me? Well, now we're just starting, so it's not sleepy time yet, okay? That comes about 20 minutes into this, then you can nap. But I want to show you something that's unique here. Watch this. Get a pen and underscore this. I will give thee riches, wealth, and honor. Now wait a minute. Solomon did not ask for that, right? Everybody, right? He didn't even ask for that. But because, watch, everybody look up here. It's just us this morning, so look up here. Because he asked for what pleased God, God gave him these other things. Did you catch that? To begin with, he didn't say, God, I would love a Walmart gift card. And if you just give me that, I could just be happy. No. He says, above everything in the world, Solomon says, I want wisdom. And so here's what God says. Because you asked for what pleased me, I will give you these other things that you didn't even ask for. Could it be that we look at things a little bit wrong? Could it be that instead of seeking God's favor, instead of seeking what He wants, maybe if we tapped into what He wants, then these other things that we really think we want, we would get those anyway. Have you ever thought about that? Here's what he says. You didn't ask for those things. You could have asked for that, Solomon, but you didn't. You asked for something that you're going to need, something that's going to please me, so I'm going to give it to you, and I'm going to give it to you in a whole big bundle. I think sometimes we've missed that. What honors the Lord? What could we ask for that would honor the Lord? So let's go through this and let me show you where we're going to get to today. Now, because of that request of Solomon, it was a humble request. The Lord gave it to him. Now, in our text verses that we're fixing to look at, are you still with me? Now, here's some happy news. Let me give you some happiness. As a preacher, I get to do this. I get to read my Bible. Woo! Okay. Well, you said, well, that's what you have to do. No, I don't have to do it. I get to do it. I don't have to pray for you. I get to do that for you. So, one of the aspects and one of the wonderful things about being a pastor of a local New Testament church is I get to look at passages week in and week out. Now, some of these things that you're familiar with, but we hope to sometimes that we tweak these a little bit that you've not thought of before. So I'm going to show you a verse that you all know, but it starts with this. It starts with two of the most important people of the Old Testament. As a matter of fact, you don't get much more I know my English will not be right, Miss Annetta, and I'm so sorry about that. You don't get more greater than this. These two men that we're fixing to see, they were the big boys of the Old Testament. Now, you listen, I don't know about you, but just to speak with one of these guys would be a thrill to thrill to thrill to no end. But now we're fixing to see both of these guys side by side. And I started looking at this story, and I started thinking, my gracious, what did people think when they saw these two men walking side by side? These are the big cheese of the Old Testament. Well, you said, what are you getting at? All right, let me show you something. Are you ready? All right. Have I got your attention? Good, I want you to do that. I want you to see 2 Kings 2:1. And we're going to springboard from this, so stay with me. And it came to pass, watch, when the Lord would take up Elijah into heaven by a whirlwind, that Elijah, watch, went with Elisha. Now, see, you're not thrilled like that, I am. Because I know what comes after this. But here, we've got two of the greatest men of our Old Testament. Now, they're not without fault. They're not perfect by any means. We understand that Elijah did some things that God had to kind of get his attention. But I'm just saying, as far as the Old Testament's concerned, we're going to see some powerful men here. Now, Elijah, Phil, bring that verse back up. And I know you probably don't get the jollies that I get when I see this again, but let me show you this. And it came to pass, now watch, when the Lord would take up Elijah into heaven by a whirlwind. How about that? Now, there is a denomination, I could mention it, but because I'm on Facebook, I don't want to mention it. There is a denomination that does not believe in the rapture. What is that? That is a rapture. This is an Old Testament picture of what you and I, if I hope, God Almighty, I hope that I'm part of that opportunity. I would love, Lord Jesus, I would love this morning that trumpet sound and the Lord would call His church home. I would love to be a part of that thing. Listen, if it's in a whirlwind, a tornado, a rainstorm, hailstorm, I don't care how it's going to be, but I'd love to be a part of that. Now think about this. The Bible says Elijah's going to be called into heaven by a whirlwind. Wow! Now, maybe it's just me, and maybe my mind clicks different than yours, and you very well hope so. I know that. But here's what I started thinking. If you knew that I was going to be raptured up in a whirlwind, here's what some of you would do. You would say, I want to stick around and see that. I want to see how this thing works. If God's going to rapture this guy up and it's going to be one of these things, I've never seen anything. By the way, wouldn't you like to see that? By the way, wouldn't you like to be a part of that? Okay. All right, so here we go. He's going to be in a whirlwind. And then Elisha knows this. He's been told this. So what's Elisha's role in all of this? You know what he says? I ain't going to leave. I ain't going to leave because I want to see this thing. Now, that's pretty good so far, right? Have I got you sucked in yet? All right, just stay with me because we just are uncovering the good part. Okay? Now, here's what we've learned. Verse number one is, Elijah is fixing to be taken up. Now, wait a minute. We just don't know when. I'm talking about if we were there, right? We don't know when. All we want to know is, when's that going to happen? We don't know that. But let me show you something that I thought was interesting. If you have a pen, get a pen out. Let me show you something. You want to see this. Everybody get a pen. Don't just look at me like I don't know what that is. It's a little pen that's got ink in it, and you used it, okay? Let me show you something. In 2 Kings 2:2, and it mentions this over and over. So if the Bible says it once, it's important, but he emphasizes this. And this is what I want to emphasize. 2 Kings 2:2. And Elijah said unto Elisha, tarry here, I pray thee, for the Lord has sent me to Bethel. Now watch this. And Elisha said unto him, or Elijah, as the Lord liveth, and as thy soul liveth, look at these words, I will not leave thee. Skip down to verse number 4 of that same chapter. And Elijah said unto Elisha, tarry here, I pray thee, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho. And he says, as the Lord liveth and my soul liveth, look at this, underscore this, I will not leave thee. Skip down to verse number 6, same thing. He says, and sent me to Jordan, and he says, as the Lord liveth and as thy soul liveth, again, I will not leave thee. Each of these verses had these same words. Not only was Elisha determined to stay by the man of God, Elijah, watch this, ask one of the greatest questions of our Bible. Now watch the question that Elijah asked. Now what, are you with me? Skip down to verse number 9. Look at this question. And it came to pass, when they were gone over, that Elijah said unto Elisha, underscore this question, what shall I do for thee? Now stop just a minute. Who was Elijah? He was a prophet, a mighty prophet of the Lord of God, of the Lord God, right? As a matter of fact, he is referred to, watch this, as a mighty prophet. You know why that's significant? It's because when Jesus came down and was doing his earthly ministry, some people said something like that. Is that Elijah raised from the dead? You remember that? So Jesus was likened unto Elijah. Elijah was a mighty man of God. Now, he knows he's fixing to be raptured up, and he asked his minister or his servant, Elisha, and says something like this. Look, I don't know when it's going to happen, but it's going to happen. But before this happens, what could I do for you? What do you really want? How would you answer that question? How would you answer that question? Now, some of you would be rightfully, you'd say something like this. Man, if I could just have good health, that would be awesome. Good health. Man, that would help me. That means when I roll out of bed of a morning, that I would know that I wouldn't just creak and crack every time I roll out of bed. Or some of you would say, if I could just meet my financial needs, man, that would just take a lot of pressure off of me. I want you to look at that one more time before I go on. What shall I do for thee? You know what he's saying? Basically, you've got a blank check. All I've got to do is sign my name at the bottom of that check, Elisha, and you put whatever you want to on there, and it's going to be given, as long as it's according to God's will. We understand that, right? Okay. Now, this is where the story starts getting very, very interesting. And here's what I want to give you now. Elisha was asking for the same spirit that empowered Elijah to be given to him. Now, I'm sorry about this, Brother Phil. Put verse number 9 back up there. We got Brother Phil back there, and he's looking at giving me dirty looks because he don't know what I'm doing. But let me show you something, because I had to do some looking here, and I want you to see what I saw. When you see verse number 9, look at that on the screen up there. He says, "What shall I do for thee before I be taken away from thee?" And Elisha says, watch this, "I pray thee, let a double portion of thy..." Now, what does that mean? Now, a lot of us, when we've always read that, watch this. A lot of us, when we've always read that, we've always thought, well, it's double everything that Elijah has always done. I'm not so sure I agree with that. "Let a double portion of thy spirit." Well, what kind of spirit is he asking about? I mean, if you're asking for a double portion of the spirit, what does that mean? Well, I'm glad you want to know that. Put this in the margin of your Bible. Put this in a circle, that verse number 9, because this is crucial that you get this in this message. There are three things of what kind of spirit that is. Number one, he asked for the spirit of faith. He asked for the spirit of faith. You see, Elijah learned to trust God in the presence and the power of God in the world. The great prophet Elijah learned that God was in control of every situation that he would face. And this is what Elisha was asking for. He was asking, look, Elijah, I want a double portion of your spirit. What spirit is that? I want a double portion of your faith. By the way, did you know that Christians living by faith is a Bible principle? Wait a minute. I'm the only one that thought that. Living by faith is a Bible principle. Did you realize something last week that I read? Pop, and I'm just serious as I can be. I've read it and I've ruminated all this all week. When I read this, I cannot get this out of my mind. It's not a big deal to you, but it's been a big deal to me all week long. Whatever is not of faith is sin. I started contemplating that all week long. So you mean to tell me that if I'm not operating in faith, come on, is that what you get out of that? That's exactly what that means. So if we as Christians, if this thing is a faith operation, Christianity, and we're not operating in that, so guess what the other alternative is? It is sin. So he's asking, I want a double portion of your faith. I want the faith that you had, Elijah. I want to know this. Whatever situation that I get in, I want to know that God's able. Now, can we say that? Wouldn't it be great if we had a double portion of faith? Wouldn't it be great instead of us just staying up all night and fretting and fuming and not getting our way and we have all these fits? Wouldn't it be great if we just had... Watch this. Wouldn't it be great if we could do this, Miss Sense? What? Couldn't do this? Well, I know God's going to take care of me. No, wait. We say that, but yet we take it all on our own self. Remember this, what I'm fixing to tell you. If you are not living in faith, everything else. So that means this to me. So, of all the places that I had to go this week, and I ran across that verse, and I just kept thinking that the Lord just kept bringing it to my mind. So that just simply means this. Why don't we, as God's people, let's just try an experiment. Let's just do it on this day on Sunday. Why don't we just believe that God can take care of us today? Why don't we just believe that? Let's not worry about Monday. Let's just think about today. Okay? So, number one is, he wanted a double portion of the spirit of faith. Number two is this, watch this, should be up there. The second is, he wanted a spirit of obedience. He wanted a double portion of his obedience. Now listen to this. Elijah did what the Lord asked him to do, even if it did not make sense. In your Christian life, have you ever sensed that God was asking you to do something that didn't make sense to you? Let me give you a case in point. Everybody knows what I'm fixing to say. And I'm not trying to insinuate anything. I'm just trying to help you. What about when God asks you to give your tithes and offerings? And you're saying, I can't. I ain't got enough. You know what he's saying? Why don't you just be obedient? Why don't you just trust me and let me see what I can do? You see, everybody in this room has been in that situation. And some of you are there now. You're just not trusting God to supply your need. I'm talking about he wanted a double portion of his faith. And number two, he wanted a double portion of his obedience. Here's what he says. Lord, I want to do whatever you want me to do, even in my mind when it doesn't make sense. Can I prove something to you in the Bible? Look, it's not on the board, so you just have to turn there. Go to 1 Kings, if you would. Let me show you something. 1 Kings, let's just skip down to verse 17. It's chapter 17. If you've got that, look at verse number 7. 1 Kings chapter 17 and verse number 7. Let me show you this. We understand that God's asking Elijah to do something here. And he says, I want you to go by this brook. And by the way, when you go by this brook, I'm going to have the most filthiest birds of God's creation to feed you. Come on, somebody grin at me, all right? Don't make sense. If God, if you want to feed me by bird, could you send a dove? It's a lot cleaner, looks better, and it's not as filthy as a raven. God, could you at least do that? No, I'm going to send the worst, filthiest, nastiest bird on the planet. The raven is going to feed you. Verse number 7 says, and it came to pass after a while that the brook dried up. Let me tell you, there was a drought in the land. Here's what God was challenging that mighty man of God. He says, you stay there until I tell you to leave. Wait a minute. If there's a drought in the land and your water supply is drying up, what are you thinking? Let's be honest. What are you thinking? You're thinking about, God, is it time to move me? God, don't you think it's time for me to go to another place where there's water? You know what God did? That didn't make sense. But then God told Elijah to do something that made less sense than that. Let me show you. Look at verse that go down in that same chapter to verse number 9. Look what he says. It don't make sense. He says, go to Zarephath, which belongeth to Zidon, and dwell there. I've got this underlined. Behold, I have commanded a widow woman there to sustain thee. Well, now it's just only getting worse. The drought is in the land. The water's drying up. Now I'm going to a widow woman. She don't have nothing. She can't even produce nothing. She don't even have the means to get anything. And Lord, you're sending me to this woman. You know what he says? Trust me. Trust me. You see, God says, I know what I'm doing. Even Elijah, when it goes against your sensibilities, I know what I'm doing. You see, you don't get this thing figured out ahead of time, but Elijah, I'm telling you, I've got what you need, and it's going to be that by that dried up brook, and it's going to be by a widow woman. Now, if there's anybody in Israel that did not have any food or supplies, guess who it was? Wait a minute, we're in a drought. Guess who had the least? A widow woman. And this is what God told him to do. Now, I'm trying to hurry. Watch. You know what I don't read here? I don't read him saying, God, could I ask you a question? Do you know what you're doing? God, I understand that you want me to move on, and I'll do that. But at least could you give me somebody that has some meat and taters in the pantry? God, I don't understand this. No, you know what he says? I'm just going to go. It doesn't make sense, but I'm going to go. Watch. Don't lose me here. Don't lose me. Woo! Everybody, watch. You know what he says? I want you to trust me when it doesn't make sense. Brother Randy, you ever been in a place like that where it didn't make sense, but God called you to trust him? Miss Betty, have you ever been in a place where it didn't make sense, but God says, I want you to trust me anyway? How many of us could understand what we're talking about? It didn't make sense. Matter of fact, you want to do the very opposite. But God says, trust me. Look at the third one, Brother Phil. Look on the screen. Not only talk about faith and obedience. Look at this. He says, I want a double portion of your courage. Now think how important this is for this man. Now watch this. One thing Elijah was known for, and that was his courage. Go to 1 Kings chapter 18. It's not on the screen, but let me show you something right quick as we wrap up. 1 Kings chapter 18, verse number 17. Look how much courage it took here. 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 17. Elijah's on the scene. He goes to meet one of the most powerful men of that era, of that day. Look what happens. And it came to pass when Ahab saw Elijah. I think there's some humor in this, but watch. That Ahab said unto him, now here's what the king's telling to Elijah. Art thou that troubleth Israel? Question. Look at that next verse. And he answered, I have not troubled Israel. Look at those next two words. Put a circle around that. But thou. Look at this. And thy father's house, in that you have forsaken the commandments of the Lord and hast followed Balaam. Now, here's what we think. So what big deal? I know. Here's what the so what big deal about that is. In that day, you did not confront the king. That was not expedient for anybody to confront the king, because here's what the end result of that would be. The end result of that would be is you have your head lopped off. The king did not have to do that. But here is this powerful Elijah that went into King Ahab and said, look, buddy, I'm not the one that's causing trouble and the drought in the land. It's you and what you are doing. Now, wait a minute. It'd be just like you trying to confront one of the national leaders of our day. How popular would that be? How popular would that be? Nancy Pelosi? It's not me, it's you! Well, let me tell you the end result of that. You're going to be arrested. But here was a man of God who stood by courage. And that's what Elisha was asking for. Please, Lord, I don't want all these earthly trinkets, but just give me that double portion of His courage. Because when I'm confronted with something that I don't understand, I just want to be able, here's what Elisha was saying, I just want to be able to stand for You, God, at all times. I don't want to back down, and I don't want to let the world dictate who I say and what I say and what I do. Lord, I just want to be Your man. Now, are you still with me this morning? I'm finished with this, and we'll pick up the next time. I want you to go to 2 Kings chapter 2 and verse number 10, and this is where we'll stop. 2 Kings chapter 2 and verse number 10. You remember Elijah asked Elijah, Elisha, ask what you want me to do. What can I do for you? Look at this. And he said, Elijah said this, thou hast asked a hard thing. What was the hard thing? The double portion. If thou see me when I'm taken from thee, it shall be so unto thee. But if not, it shall not be so. But I want everybody in here for the next 2-3 minutes, hear this. Now, I'm fixing to stop, so wake up, watch. If you have a pen, would you underscore these words, a hard thing? Would you just underscore that for me this morning? Let me explain that. I thank God that there are men and women in this room and in our community that's not afraid to ask God for a hard thing. So many of our prayers is so limited and so minute that it don't even hardly register past these purlings up in the attic. It didn't even get that far. Because the greatest prayer that many utter is, God bless this food to my nourishment of my body. I'm not saying you ought not to pray that, but I'm just saying sometimes we are to pray God for the hard things. For the hard things of life. What's the hard things? Well, whatever's going on. Can we not pray that God would intervene in all the situations that's going on in the world today? And the proverbial answer is yes. Could we not pray that souls would be saved at Calvary Baptist Church every Sunday? And the answer is yes. Could we not pray that the seats of the community of this sanctuary would be filled every Sunday? And the answer is yes. Why don't we ask hard things? I would venture to say 98% of you in this room will not ask hard things. Here's what I've learned. I only get what I pray for. What if I don't pray for it? Well, guess what? I might not get it. I'm just asking you and I'm challenging you. See, Elisha had enough sense. He wanted to ask for the hard things. And you know, when I read these things in a book, in the Bible, it challenges me because I see these men and women of the Bible that ask for difficult things. Joshua, you know what he says? God, stop the sun. He had enough courage to ask God to stop the sun and the moon. God says, okay. How many of your prayers would be equivalent to anything like that? Well, Lord, I just don't think we can do that because we're just little and we just don't have all of the stuff that those guys... No. God is the very same God as He was in Elijah's day. And He... Watch this, and I'm done. He double dog dare you to pray. Big prayers. Hard prayers. I've read this several times in the Old Testament. Nothing is too hard for God. I love that. Thou hast asked a hard thing. Now, this is just me and I'm closing. I hope when I get to heaven and I see all of the grandeur of God and He says, boy, you wasn't afraid to ask hard things. Man, you just kept asking. And you just kept asking. You know why? Because I just keep believing and keep believing that God is able. Now, here's where it falls into your lap. If you really believe God was able, it would elevate our prayer lives tenfold. The trouble is, we don't believe God's able. And so we just pray down here on surface prayers. God be with them and be with me and help my family. And Lord, if there's any prayer left over, throw it down to the preacher because you know he needs it. What happens if we would just pray hard prayers? God, I want to be like that Elijah of his day. I want the double portion of his faith. I want a double portion of His obedience. And I want that double portion of His courage. What happens? You see, there are some people that just dare God. Are we? Are we as a church even close to that? Well, preacher, I don't really know this prayer thing. You talk about it so much. And I struggle in that area. It shows that we struggle in that area. Because if we really believe God, the hard things, I believe that we would see much more answered prayers. Can I challenge you with this as we close? Would you bow your head and close your eyes? And I want you to be as brutally honest as you possibly can. I mean, as brutally honest with yourself as you've ever been in your life. Preacher, there is a hard thing that's in my life right now. And it is a very, very difficult thing. And I'm challenged this morning to pray those hard prayers, and I really don't even know where to begin. Because whatever this issue is, it just has me at the point of despair. And I don't even know how to get to the point of praying those hard prayers that you're talking about. But preacher, I need God's favor. I need God's help on this. And I desire God to do something mighty in my life and in my family. And preacher, you know that my heart is tender towards this, and I need those, ask God for those hard prayers. Maybe the reason we don't pray those hard prayers is because maybe God wants you to do something and get involved in something and speak to somebody. Maybe that's the problem. Maybe we've just grown so complacent and comfortable that we don't even care if the church are closed. We don't even care if people are not being saved. We've just lost interest. Let me ask you this, as you view your situation. Preacher, in my life right now, there is a hard issue that I'm facing. If you would be real honest with me and you'd raise your hand so I could pray with you this week, everybody in this room, preacher, I'm facing a hard thing this morning. I've got something very difficult that I'm dealing with. Yes. Amen. Anyone else? Anyone else? Anyone else? Many hands went up. Many said, preacher, the hard issues is just overwhelming me. Just for a brief moment, we'll not drag this on, but I just firmly believe in my spirit that this altar needs to be opened up this morning. For you that raised your hand to give God the glory and thank Him in advance how He's going to intervene in your situation. I don't know how. I don't know whatever you're facing. But boy, I know God knows. Wouldn't it be great this morning if you would just say, God, I want that double portion. And I'm just going to pray those hard prayers. Would you stand to your feet all over this room? You raised your hand. You are to come right now and give it to God.